issue with it. Let me know if you can hear me. I'm trying these new headphones. Let me know if the music is too loud. Blessings. Awesome. Hello, Ditria, how you doing? God bless you. The music's a bit loud. Yeah, I'm just getting started. Do me a favor, just get on and share this with all your followers. Share it on Twitter, share it on Facebook, share it on Periscope. As I share it online. Creation was beautiful. I love that. It was awesome. God really moved on me. He really touched my heart. It was a solemn experience. Shalom. Glory to God. If it's your first time, let me know as well. I'm glad you guys can hear me. If you haven't shared this, share this. Let me know if you listen to my other scope. I was on earlier today as well. Let me know if you were blessed. A consecration is putting away things, your material possessions, or just things that you enjoy doing for Christ, for God, to hear God's voice better. So I didn't talk to nobody. I didn't watch any shows. We watched no TV. I didn't watch any movies, and you know. And everything I did was centered around God, around Christ, around intimacy with Him. It's like a shut-out period when it's literally just you and God for a specific amount of days or hours. So thank you. So I was getting ready to, before I get started, just let me know where you're from, where you're tuning from. Let me know if it's your first time. As I said, that one of the things that God laid on my heart to speak on, to do a lot more, Ottawa, Canada, bless you. To do a lot more is to do a bit more teaching on here. I usually get on here and we pray, we do deliverances, we cast out demons, but I'm going to spend a few weeks doing a lot of teachings. I'm still going to be praying, we're still going to be doing the deliverances and the healings, but in order to build a platform, a lot of people really don't know that they don't have any ground in Christ, in the Word of God. And God laid it on my heart to do a series of teaching about Jesus, you know, who He is to us. So tonight we're going to be discussing this topic, which I've entitled Understanding Christ, Jesus Christ as the Word of God. Jesus as the Word of God. I thank you. So let me know as we get started. I don't think this is... there'll be any reason. Let me know how you've been since the, if you went on earlier today, let me know how you've been since the last fast that we did together. Talia, God bless you. Let me know how you've been since the last fast. Then I'll get right into the word, which God has given to me. John chapter 1 and 1. We're going to start there. John 1 and 1. The word of the Lord says that, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. We're going to begin there. So many people, they don't have any foundation. And a lot of people have a hard time. You know, I talk to Christians. They say, oh, one day I don't think I'm saved. And, you know, they have no endurance. Everything is a problem. Why? Because they don't know who Christ is. Bible says, other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. A lot of times we go to churches, they make material possessions our foundation. They make, you know, power their foundation. They make all these other things their foundation. And they ignore and they neglect the basic foundation of Christ Jesus. And that is why so many believers, they want to start learning all these things, all of this. I'll give you an example. I don't know if he's on, but it was a man who got on one of my scopes a while back. And he kept asking questions. Oh, do you think we're in the last day? Do you think, you know, this the revelation period? Do you think Christ is coming soon? And all these deep questions. And then at the end of the scope, he's like, I don't even know if I'm saved. You know, so it baffles me. You know, you don't even know your standing in God, but yet you want to learn all these other things. You want to learn about deliverance and healings and prophecy and casting out of devils and all this, but you don't even know if you're saved or not. You want to know about the end time, what's to come, you know, all the creatures, the principalities, but you don't even know who Christ is. You don't even know who he is. So even if you learn about those things, how are they going to benefit you? How are they going to profit you? And we see people being tossed to and fro by every wind of doctrine because they have no stability. They have no foundation. So we're going to deal with that. And I'm going to deal with, today I'm dealing with Jesus Christ. Understanding Christ, Jesus as the Word of God. Once again, before I get started, let me know if the music is too loud. Turn it down a little bit and I'll change the song. Let me know if you can hear me clearly as well. We're dealing with Jesus Christ as the Word. And if you haven't shared this, share with on Facebook, on Periscope, and on Twitter. We are dealing with Jesus Christ as the Word of God. Jesus Christ as the Word of God. The Bible says that in the beginning, John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was with God. 1 John 5:7 says there are three that bear witness in heaven. And these three, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. The Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost. Now we're called to understand that the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and that Word is Jesus Christ. How can I explain it to you? It's as practical as can be. When God sat on his throne and he imagined something, that's God the Father. Now when he said, let there be light, those words, let there be, the words of God were literally Jesus. Jesus is literally the Word of God. That's what he was referred to in heaven, the Word of God. Now, the creation of that light, since it didn't just materialize out of thin air, the creation of that light was done by the Holy Spirit. He's known as the arm of God. Anywhere you hear in the Bible, the arm, the finger, the hand of God, that's the Holy Spirit. He's the one who forms. When the Bible says the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground, that is the Holy Spirit who formed you from the dust of the ground. He's the hand of God. But the Word of God, Lord of God, is Jesus. And why is this important? The Bible says that in John 1:3, that all things were made by him, and without him was not anything made that was made. All things were made by him. And that is also confirmed in Colossians. If you have notes, you should write this down. Colossians chapter 1 from verse 15 to 17. I'm going to read it. And he said, who is the image of the invisible God? So Jesus is the image of the invisible God. If you weren't on the last Periscope, I would advise you to go back and watch it after, where I give you a greater understanding of the relationship between God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and how Jesus can be God, you know, how he can be God and still come in the flesh. Glory to God. So go back and watch that. So we see that it says, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him, all things were created that are in heaven, on earth. Everything in heaven, every creature, all things in heaven and earth, they were created by Jesus. Visible and invisible. Whether they be thrones, dominions, principalities, powers, all things were made by and for him. Now, this is important. Why is this important? Because a lot of times people like to paint a picture that there's a creature, there are demons, there are powers that are greater than Jesus. So many times, you know, I deal in deliverance and I come across so many people who, by the time, you know, when I hear them explain their situation to me or what they're going through, I can tell that in their mind they've come to believe that demon, that problem, problem, that stronghold that they've been dealing is somehow greater than Jesus. Let me tell you something. There's nothing that you can ever face. There's nothing that you can ever go through that can be greater than Jesus. Why? Because there's no created creature that's greater than the Creator. The Bible says even principalities, even powers. Amen. Some of us, we're not even dealing with principalities and powers. We're still dealing with the little roaches that chases around in our dreams and little snakes that we run away from when we're sleeping and little nightmares, you know, and we're so afraid and the devil puts so much fear in us and makes us believe that what we're going through or the enemy that we're facing is somehow greater than Jesus. But that's not true. All things were made by and for him. Whether those things are submitted to him currently or in a state of rebellion. Let me tell you this. A man of God once said, Derek Prince, he said that there is no creature, there's no created being that God has used more than he's used the devil. So even the devil, in his fallen and rebellious state, God is still using him. So there's nothing out of his grasp. You know, I see the pictures online and they paint a portrait of God arm wrestling the devil. That's not possible. That's not possible. The devil is our adversary. He's the adversary of the saints. He's nowhere near an adversary of God. God uses him in his fallen state. He's our problem. He's not God's problem. When he rebelled in heaven, God didn't stand up out of his throne and say, oh, devil, come, let's box. No, he sent his angel Michael to take care of it. So regardless of what you're going through or who you're facing or what being, what demon, you know, what power in heaven and hell under the sea, in the ocean, in the air, you know, we like to talk fancy in the church, you know, heavenly beings and principalities and demons and Leviathan and a lot of preachers and prophets, they'll make you feel as if these things are so great, but at the end of the day, they are created. The Bible says all things were made by him. Thrones, dominions, principalities, and powers. There's nothing greater than Jesus. There's nothing stronger than him. There's no power that compares to him. So I tell people, when you look at your situation, are you looking at it with fear, or are you looking at it knowing that Christ is more than able? All things were made by him. This is not, you know, the movies where a man will create a robot and the robot is going to kill. No, it's nothing like that. All things were made by him. Anything under him, anything that was made by him is subject to him. Is subject to him. Lord God. Now, verse 4 of John 1. Remember, I'm teaching on Jesus Christ as the Word of God. As the Word, should I say. John 1, 4. And it says, in him was life, and that life was the light of men. So in the Word, the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, the same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life. In that Word was life, and that life was the light of men. Listen to this. That life was the light of men. Psalms 119, verse 105 says, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. See, the Word of God is a light unto our path. It gives us direction. For so many of you who you know, you're losing direction. You don't know who you are. You don't know what you are. I coined a quote, Lord of God, and the Holy Spirit gave me this. He spoke to me. He said, and I say it often, you can never know who you are until you know who Christ is. Why? Because he's the light that lighteth our path. You can never know where to go or how to get there unless you know Jesus. And how? He's the Word. I mean, he doesn't appear to me. I know he's appeared to somebody. He doesn't appear to me randomly and say, Prophet Ugo, make a left turn, then go that way. The Holy Spirit does lead me, but he's the light, that light of our path. Lord of my God. He gives us direction. For those of you who are always confused, you don't know where to go, you're falling to all types of heresies and false doctrines, you're following all these leaders and all these false churches. Why? Because you don't know the Word of God. Stop looking for prophecy and get in the Bible. Glory to God. Stop looking. Stop searching. See, I have enough. I love prophetic words. Glory to God. I seek for them as well. But that does not replace your knowledge of the Word of God. There's no, you should not be going around searching for prophetic words if you don't know your Bible. Because someone can tell you something that's completely contradictory to Scripture and you just eat it up because you like that person. But if you know the Word, He'll light your path. He'll lead you. He'll guide you. See, sometimes we tend to look at the Bible as a history book. But when you look, when you flip through these pages and you understand that every page, Old Testament and New Testament, anytime you read a word, a dot from this book, you're looking at Jesus. When we begin to look at it like that, we'll take the Word of God more seriously. We're looking at Jesus. Every page, every word, every letter is Jesus. He is the Word that was made flesh. Now, verse 5, it says, and the light, that light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. The light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. I want you to understand this, that the Word of God brings illumination. The devil likes to hide in darkness. Demons like to hide in darkness. Ephesians 5:14, it says, awake thou that sleepest, and Christ shall give thee light. Some of you are in spiritual slumber in one area of your life or the other. The Bible says that my people perish for lack of knowledge. You know, there are certain things that we're not knowledgeable about, that the devil has had a grip over our life, and we can't have victory over it for that simple reason. But when you get in the Word of God, you begin to study, you begin to read, and you begin to meditate on it, you receive illumination in those dark parts of your life. Those things that you didn't even know that were there, that are applicable to you, you receive light. Knowledge of the Scripture is your strongest weapon. And that's why when I get on here, you see me casting out demons, I'm constantly reminding the demons that I know my Word. I know what the Bible says about them. Some of you, your issue, the things you struggle with, is because you don't know what the Word of God says about that thing that you're going through. I can get on here and say, you know, the Word of the Lord says, God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of love, power, and of a sound mind. And that takes me to my next point. John 13:15 says Scripture cannot be broken. Luke 21:3 says heaven and earth shall pass away, but my word shall not pass. I don't care what you're going through. I don't care how long you've been going through it. It does not make you exempt from the Word of God. Your situation does not make you exempt from the Word of God. Bible says, let God be true and every man be a liar. So when you're coming with me and you bring a situation and you're trying to make me feel as if, you know, the Word of God is not working for you, I'm going to call you a liar. Because let God be true and every man be a liar. We cannot pick and choose what Scripture is applicable to our lives. I heard someone say, you know, before, oh, can I agree with certain parts of the Scripture and then not? No, you can't do that. You can't pick and choose. You can't cherry pick, glory to God. Your problem, that situation you're going through, regardless of how real it is. You see, that's what the Bible says, that we walk by faith and not by sight. But faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. By the time you begin to hear the Word of God, now the Word goes into you. It's not a visible thing. It's invisible. And we look to the things that are not unseen, because the things that are seen are are temporary. Now, when you begin, the problem that some of you have is that you're looking at your situation in the flesh, and it's so real to you that somehow the devil has made it realer than the Word of God. And if the devil has made your situation realer than the Word of God, then he succeeded in making your problem realer than Jesus is to you. I'll say it again. If the devil has made your problem and your situation realer than the Word of God, that you wake up in the morning, you're so sad, you're so depressed, you're so frustrated, you think the Bible is a lie because it's not working for you, then he succeeded in making that problem realer than Jesus to you. Are you in that position? But I'm here to tell you, the scripture cannot be broken. I don't care how long you've been battling with that thing. I don't care how long it's been bothering you. I don't care how many preachers you've gone to, they couldn't do nothing for you. It's not as real as this word is. I don't care how strong that fear is. Bible says, the Bible says that he's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind. I pray for some people who struggle with insomnia, and it's as real as it can get. They can't sleep at night. But when I hear them, that insomnia, it's nothing to me. Because what does the Bible say? The Bible says that the God giveth his beloved rest. So why should I let your problem become more real to me than that verse? So when I pray for them, I stand on the Word of God. Some of you, your problem is you don't know the Word of God. You don't know Jesus like that. You don't know the Word of God. And if you don't know the Word of God, then you don't know Jesus. But when you go through that problem and that situation, and you find the verse that speaks to you, you stand on it, regardless of if it doesn't happen immediately, if nothing changes in me, you stand on that word, because you must understand that this is a spiritual book. This is a spiritual book. This is not a history book. So many people are reading this like a history book, and they read about it and say, oh yeah, there's no more healings, there's no more deliverances. Says who? There's no more, you know, God can't do that now, you got to go to physical. Says who? Says who? That problem, whatever it is, it cannot. See, Bible says that there are things that exalt itself above the knowledge of God. And you have to bring your mind to the place where nothing exalts itself against the knowledge of God. Should I say, not above the knowledge of God, but against it. We have things that are fighting us, and the devil's going to fight you. He's going to tempt you. He's going to bring all these things and make you feel as if the Bible doesn't work for you. But you don't stand on that. You make the Word of God your source, your foundation. Listen to this. I want you to hear this part. Joshua 1:8, it says, the book of the law shall not depart from out of thy mouth. The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. There's a popular secular artist, DJ Khaled. He's going around talking about the key to success. But the word of the Lord says that the key to success is when the book of the law, the word of God, does not depart from thy mouth. Now, I want you to hear this revelation. I need you to understand this. The Bible says that the word of God is the sword of the spirit. We say that at times, but let's break that down. It's the sword of who? Whose sword is it? It's not my sword. The word of God is the sword of the Holy Spirit. The word of God is the sword of the spirit. The reason why so many people quote scripture, they memorize scripture, but there's no evident effect in their life, is because it's not yielded to the Holy Spirit. They're memorizing and they're quoting that scripture in flesh. I know some of you could do it, are doing it. Let me say that. It's in the flesh. You haven't yielded it to the Holy Spirit. When Jesus was tempted in the wilderness, he didn't go on Google and say, hold on, devil. Let me go and Google what the Bible says about this. Let me go and Google what the law says about this. He didn't go to his notes. He didn't go to his phone. He didn't say, let me go through my notes. He had the word inside of him. And a lot of your problem is no one wants to memorize the scriptures anymore. If you're unable to memorize the scripture and have it written in your heart, then there's nothing for the Holy Spirit to use. But because the Bible says he brings all things to memory. But when the word of God is written in your heart, the moment you go through that situation, the Holy Spirit will bring that word up. Some of you, there's nothing in you for the Holy Spirit to pull out. That's why you're always falling into temptation. That's why you're always going through a problem. There's nothing in you. There's no word in you. And that's why the moment that you go through it, then you begin to search the scripture, and then you read it one time, and then you go to bed. But it has to be in your heart. It's got to be in your heart. The devil is not going to come to you and say, look, I'm going to tempt you in a week from now. I'm going to bring a sexual temptation to you in a week from now. Make sure you go and study the word and memorize some verses so that when I come, you know, you'll be ready. He's not going to say that. He's not going to warn you and give you some time to get ready. You have to have the word of God inside of you. But the moment the devil finds that darkness in your life, that place that is not illuminated by the word of God, which is in your heart, then he brings out a temptation that is against it. And since you don't have the word in you, then you fall. Get the word of God in your heart. It must be yielded to the Spirit. Listen, you know, people, they take their Bible, they put it under their pillow. They tear out the pages and they put it in their wallet and they do all these weird things with the Bible, and some of those things are witchcraft to begin with, but they tattoo it on their skin. You know, all that's garbage. That's the flesh, because it's the Holy Spirit's sword. If you're doing that, the Holy Spirit's not going to come in the middle of the night and pick up your Bible from under your pillow and throw it at a demon. No. That's not how he works. It's got to be in your heart. It has to be in your heart. You have it in your pillow? Yeah, that's different. If you have it on the pillow so you can reach it, that's different. But some people put it under the pillow so they can sleep. Oh, it protects them from demons. That's the flesh. That's the flesh. Now listen to this. John 14 and 15 says, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. Some people, you know, you can't even keep his commandments because you don't even know them. I come across so many people, especially in this generation. They don't even know that horoscopes is witchcraft and an abomination before God. Why? Because they don't know the word. Bible says, an observer of time, that's an abomination before the Lord God. You're doing you're doing the yoga and meditating and you're going to fortune telling and you're reading your horoscope every morning. That stuff is an abomination before God, and that shows you don't love Jesus. Why? Because you don't even have his commandments inside of you. The Lord dealt with me on this heavily this past week. Your love for Jesus can never exceed your love for the Word of God. If every time you open the Bible, you fall asleep, that shows where you are in your relationship with Jesus. If every time you want to get in the Word, you get carried away, you start texting, you start doing all these things, you can't stay still, and then you forget about it, that shows where you are in your relationship with Jesus. If every time you want to read the word, you want to study, you just can't do it, that shows where you are in your relationship with Jesus. Your love for him can never exceed his word, because it is through his word that we get to know him, because he is the word. This Bible you're looking at is is not is although it's in physical form. He says, the words I speak unto you, they're a spirit and they are life. This is a spiritual book, and this word, every time you read it, brings a greater revelation of who Jesus is. Of who Jesus is. So stop chasing all these people around and start chasing the word of God. We think that we love them. We dine, we dance, we run, we shout, we speak in tongues, and we go to church, but we don't. But we only pick up the Bible once a week. We don't study. We don't read. We don't meditate. It's more than 15 minutes before you go to bed. It's more than 10 minutes when you wake up. How much of this is in your heart? How much of it is in you? Some of you, the problems that you're going through, you wouldn't go through it if you had the word of God in you. Because the moment the devil will bring it, you will have something. The Holy Spirit will have something to pull out. And then what? The book of the law should not depart from thy mouth. Then you proclaim it. You speak it into the air. You speak it into your surroundings. You speak of the word of God. So, do you love Jesus? Do you really love him like you think you do? Because there is no love for him outside of his word. I don't care how much you get on your face and cry. You don't know him. If you don't know this word, you don't know him. If you're not seeking to get filled with this word, you don't know him. You can do everything else. You can prophesy, you can pray, you can preach, you can do all those things, you can cast out demons, but you will never know him. You'll never love him as you should if you don't have this word. Why? Because he is the word of God. He is the word. He's truth. The word of God is truth. Understand that. It's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction. It's truth. Some of you, you're on YouTube too much. I had someone who's watching all this stuff that called the Holy Ghost a woman. I had someone else who was watching some stuff. And then, you know, all this weird stuff that the people watch. Like, you know, what's the point? Just get in the word of God. Get in the word of God. Stop forcing things. Commune with the Holy Spirit. If you spend as much time in the word as you spent on your face, on your clothes, and going shopping, on YouTube, you might just be saved. Glory to God. Get the word of God in you. Because this is Jesus. And I love Jesus. So I'm forced to love his word. He took me to a new depth in him over the past week. And now when I read the word, it's a life to me. I laugh at the people inside of it. It's beautiful. It's not boring. It's not boring. The gospel, it shouldn't be hid to you. Some of you, you're in darkness because you don't have enough word in you. The devil has blinded your mind. I'm going to pray for all of you. I'm going to pray that God give you a greater understanding of his word and a greater love for his word. Because the gospel should not be hid. The Bible says, if our gospel be hid, it's hid to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world has blinded the eyes of them that believe not, lest the glorious light of the gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine among them. But let the glorious light of this word illuminate your life. And Holy Spirit just spoke to me right now. He said, some of you, you're afraid to read the word. Because you know that when the light shines, it's a spotlight. And you can't hide in your sin anymore. You can't hide in your mess, in your little secrets. that little thing that you know is not right, but you've been hiding it. And that's why you don't want to read the word, because you know it's going to convict you. But I'm speaking this, and I'm praying it brings conviction to your heart. You can't hide when the light of Christ is shining on you. It'll make you reevaluate yourself. It'll make you strive and seek to be more like Him. Stop running away. Stop running away from it. It shouldn't be boring to you. That's a demon. You shouldn't be constantly falling asleep when it's time for you to study the word. That's a demon. I believe there's a demon behind fear of the Bible. So many Christians, none of them want to read the Bible. Nobody wants to meditate on His word. All we know is John 3:16. That's all we know. That's not how it should be. Glory to God. I want you to understand this. That when you have the word of God in you, it'll keep you safe from error. Some of you, the music you listen to, the things you watch, the people you're around, even the saved folk you're around, they're messy. But when you have the word of God in you, it'll tell you. It'll let you know. It'll speak to you concerning everything around you. Lord of God. So I'm going to pray for you guys before I get off. And I'm going to pray that God instill a greater love, a greater thirst, and a greater desire for His word, His undiluted word. I want you to repeat after me, wherever you are. I want you to say, Lord, Lord Jesus, I repent. I repent for neglecting your word. I repent for not loving you as I should. For not loving the word as I should. I pray, Jesus, that you illuminate the eyes of my understanding. That you help me love you and your word as I should. That this word bring light to every darkness in my life. In Jesus' name, amen. I'm going to pray for you guys. Lord, I pray for an illumination. Let the light of Christ begin to shine upon everyone. I come against every demon that I wish to make them not read the word of God. Every spirit of pride that I make them fall asleep while reading and studying the word, let it leave right now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Every veil of the devil that's been placed over their eyes in order to stop them from understanding the mysteries and the word of God, I command that veil to be torn into pieces right now. And I speak to their spirits. I said, awake, thou that sleepest, and Christ shall give thee light. Every spirit that's asleep, I call you, I command you to wake up this very second in the name of Jesus. I pray, let the word of God become more real than every situation, than every problem, even health disorders. For the word of the Lord says that by His stripes we are healed. Oh, by His stripes. He was beaten and bruised for you. A crown of thorns they placed upon His head. That blood that washed away your sins, every spirit of doubt, every spirit of shame and guilt, I said the blood of Jesus has washed away your sins. That blood that dripped down from His head when they put that crown of thorns on it. That blood that splattered from His back when they whipped it. That blood that gushed out from His side when they pierced it. That blood, that precious blood of Jesus, it's redeemed you it's cleansed you. You've received the washing by the water of the word. And I command every infirmity to leave, every sickness and every disease to yield itself and to submit to the power of the word of Jesus. But what the Lord says, that at the mention of his name, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Let everything contrary to his word begin to confess the supremacy of Jesus. Let every sickness, every disease, begin to bow down to the Lord God. I curse cancer. I curse diabetes and anxiety and anorexia and anemia and sickle cell disorder. I curse lupus. I curse high blood pressure. I curse every disease, asthma. I command that it be, I curse every fibroid, every tumor, every growth. I command you to shrink right now by the reason of the blood of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I pray for a healing from the crown of your head to the sole of your feet. Let the balm of Gilead begin to wash you. Let the precious blood of Jesus begin to surround you. Let it begin to wash you this second, and let there be healing. I come against every spirit of depression and sadness. I command you to leave right now in the name of Jesus. I command there to be peace in your mind. He says, my peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth, but I give unto you. That peace of God which passeth all understanding. He said, those that believe on me, those who keep their mind stayed on me, they shall be in perfect peace. Receive the peace of God. I said, receive that peace. Every mind wandering spirit, every demonic memories that keep coming back, every spirit of this of trauma, every fear, every apprehension, every anxiety, I said, receive peace right now to your soul. Receive peace to your spirit this second in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the Son of the living God. Let his glory overshadow you. Let the breath of God meet you. Lord, let your breath begin to meet them. Your breath, let me know when. Your breath, the breath of God, the breath of God, begin to meet them. I speak life. I say that your sickness is not unto death, but that the glory of God shall be made manifest. Come out. Come out. Come out of it. Every sickness, every infirmity, every disease, I bind you and I command you to leave. I speak to every demon under the sound of my voice. I said, you don't have a right to dwell inside of them. You're awaiting for judgment on the last day. You've been made subject unto me. By the name of Jesus. And I pray in that precious name of Jesus that everything that is not of God, every demon spirit, every satanic form of contamination, every initiation into witchcraft and the occult be broken right now in the name of, I said, let the Lord begin to release a fire. I said, a fire among you, a fire in your body, a fire in your bones, a fire from the crown of your head to the sole of the feet. Let his fire begin to purify and cleanse right now. If you have a pain in your body, if you have aches, I want you to move that part of your body. I pray for the person who had a pain from diabetes. I said, let that pain begin to diminish and cease right now. I speak to you, for by his stripes we are healed. And he sent his word, and his word healeth our disease. He bore our sicknesses and our infirmities. I command that pain to cease, diminish, and leave right now in the name of Jesus. as I receive life. Every pain in their head. Receive life. I breathe the breath of God on you. As I receive it wherever you are. Let that cloud of glory fall upon you. Let the anointing begin to fall upon you and destroy every yoke of the devil in the name of Jesus. Let the light of Christ begin to shine inside of you. If you have diabetes, I want you to get some water and just drink it. As I receive a washing of your blood. Receive a washing of your blood. In the precious name of Jesus. Let me know how you're feeling. I give you glory, Jesus. If you believe in God for healing for your family members, I want you to put your hand on that part of your body. On that, if you know where they're struggling with, put your hand on your part of your body, on your body, and believe for their healing. You felt something go through your body from head to toe. That's the power of God. That's His healing virtue. I pray. Just put your hand on your body. Or if they're around you, go lay hands on them. Is she around you? Scoliosis. If she's around you, go put your hand on her back. Go lay your hand on her back. And I'm going to pray for her. And give me her name. If you have family members and they're around you, go to them. If it's your children, go lay hands on them. I'm going to pray for Seth. There was someone else here as well who was laying hands on their daughter. I pray for Seth. I pray for Seth. I said, let the healing virtue of God flow inside of him from the crown of his head to the sole of his feet. Let every organ in his body begin to function at maximum capacity in the name of Jesus. Let it begin to function as it should in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I said, Lord, that's your son. Sanctify him by the washing of your word. Cleanse him. Every demon, every spirit, I command you to hold your peace and leave in the name of Jesus. What's her name? Fithutu do ushedeva asavadeva. Rupevi suku shedevi ithende ufa. Mave sondo leveve vindianta mandi. Rupo usole vive. Nemia, I pray for Nemia. I command that spirit of infirmity. I command it to leave her right now in the name of Jesus. Every spirit of stiffness in her back, everything wrapped around her spinal cord, wrapped around her back, I command you to leave her right now in the name of Jesus. I said a healing from the crown of her head to the sole of her feet. Let the fire of God begin to work its way through her. Lord, let your glory rest upon her. Let your anointing, let your power rest upon her. And let her receive your healing, her healing. In the name of, I pray against lupus. I pray for everyone else who's battling, who's struggling with these diseases. I come against lupus. I say freedom in the name of Jesus. Healing, even to Leticia, in the name of Jesus. I pray for thyroids. I come against every growth, every fibroid, every tumor, everything that's not of God. I command it to shrink and leave. Everything in the womb that's not of God, I draw you out. I draw you out of their body. I draw you out of their body. I draw you out of their body. Every disease, every sickness, everything that's not of God. I said, I draw you out of their body right now in the name of Jesus. Just move that part of your knee. I curse cancer. I said, I curse you. And curses the man who hangs on the tree. Christ has hung on that tree. Every cancer that is as a result of curses, of generational curses, that curse is broken by the reason of the blood of Jesus. And let healing be their portion in the name of Jesus. Lord, I give you the glory. I give you the honor, I give you the adoration. I thank you for these healings. I thank you for these deliverances. I thank you for these restorations. I command, Lord, I pray that you begin to give them a greater hunger and a thirsting for your word. Let them begin to love your word more than they love themselves in the name of Jesus. I pray against every arthritis, against every sickness, every disease. Lord, as I pray, I know you are the one who does the healing, that you will release your angels to go and speak to them, that you will release your angels to go and minister to them. In the name of Jesus, I pray for Brittany's mind. In the name of Jesus, I said, peace be unto her mind. Let every thought be brought under the subjection of Christ. Every voice that's not of God, which seeks to speak to her ear, let it be silenced in the name of Jesus. And Brittany, start reading your word more. If you didn't watch this full scope, go back and rewatch the scope. It's important. Read your word. That'll help you in that area. I thank you all. Remember, email me with prayer requests. Email me with testimonies. Go to my website. Google Ezeji. I thank you, Lord God Almighty. You have done great things. You have done. He's done great things. Oh, Mahasavalu Shudavo. Mikhail, you got the job. Glory to the Most High God. You got the job. That's awesome. I thank God for that. So, I'll see you guys soon. Tomorrow is Wednesday. If I'm on, I probably won't be on too much tomorrow. But I'll be on at nighttime, and we're going to pray again. I'll see you. Be blessed. If you haven't watched this first thing, go back and rewatch it. If you didn't watch the other one, go back and watch it. Spirit of Vital Love, glory to God. Email me your testimonies. I want to hear your testimonies, guys. God bless you. I love you all. See you soon. Sleep well, dream well. In Jesus' name. Amen. Good night.